sent safely to the people. Today, we read from the gospel, of Luke. In the scripture, we read Mary's song of praise and joy. There must have been times when Mary was frightened, worried, fearful, and sad. But we have these words of joy, even in a time when she was unsure of the future. Her words can guide us to look for the joy of God, even when things may be uncertain for us.
Joy is different than happiness. Preach a whole sermon on that. It's good. One thing I'm remembering as we are gathering together is that the Christmas elf has visited Aldersgate early and given us all gifts in our pew pockets in front of you. You might notice a couple of new things this morning. Let me see if I can find one. One is that we have our new hymnals. These are the 3000 series songs, so we're not going to use any of them today. Isn't that good? Another thing that you may see this morning is these. I want to thank Carl Lynch for being in the Finance Committee. Many of us give to the church online, electronically, and so when the offering plate comes around, we don't have anything to put in. We feel a little awkward maybe about that. If you want to put something in the plate, if you give online, just to show that you're participating in the offering, you can toss one of these in the offering plate, and they'll just magically reappear in the pew pockets the next Sunday. But that way you have the gesture that goes along with your offering. What's that?
I told them, I said something.
You don't like them?
That size.
It's a really big offering. That's
what big small.
Yeah. You have one. Well, maybe the next edition. All right. So beginning worship, we always pray together. You shared your prayer requests with me this morning on a sheet of paper and in advance. So now that we've shared our joys and our concerns, let's pray. God, you've heard all these prayers. Now I ask that you would hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The special music this morning is being brought to us by the children.
Yes?
No?
What? I don't know.
Well, okay, then. What?
No, because we're saving it for next week.
Saving it for next week for the Christmas pageant. I'm always the last person to know. Okay, it's time for the children to come forward for the children's moment.
You've already did it, so...
Yeah. Yes, you did. Okay, somebody keep track. It was Lucy and then TJ. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, Jesus Christ, the Lord."
Next one.
All right. Well, Lauren already went. Let's see. And Minnie go?
Yeah,
they
called it Paul.
Paul! Paul was the next. You want to run up here and open the door? No. Okay.
A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside says to you, "Don't bother me, the door's already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything." I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shame and audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Ashton. I know you have responsibilities for the pageant, so we'll run along there. Thank you very much. First time Ashton has been a liturgist. Lord God, you brought joy to our hearts this morning, and we thank you for that. We ask now that you would bring wisdom and instruction to us, that you would open our minds and our hearts to you, and help us to hear this word this morning. We ask that you would help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. That translation was just a little bit different than the one I was reading from. What is it? Shameless audacity? Is that what it said, the phrase? Isn't that wonderful? Imagine your shameless audacity and prayer to ask God for anything. That is a different sermon. So I'm going to stay on the one I wrote, okay? Well, so Calvin had to go to the eye doctor recently. I don't know if you saw Calvin, my 8-year-old, with cute little professor glasses on. And I'm glad he's not in here because I don't want to embarrass him. He's so cute. But he was in school and they do the screening, you know, through all the classrooms, and he failed that screening. And then so we took him into the eye doctor. We took Wesley too, because Wesley's growing so fast right now. His eyesight is changing quickly. And Calvin walked into the optometrist office and just, you know, if you've been in one, you see the lights are kind of dim, right, just a little bit. There's all these crazy machines all around, sort of medieval, right? Like the different ones where you put your chin on here and it pumps the air into your eye, and the ones where the lights line up and things like that. And so he kind of walked in with real big eyes, and he climbs up in the big seat that's made for adults, and here's that big bug eyes thing. I tried to Google this, and I couldn't find the name of it. Does anyone know what that's called, that huge, the two big round discs that look like film canisters that come over your eyes and change? Do you know what that's called? I don't, okay. Google didn't either. I didn't know how to phrase the question. So we're going to call it the bug eyes thing, because I have no other term. Has anybody in this room not been to the eye doctor? Never been. So you all know what I'm talking about. Good, yes, we're all blind around here. We're blind, but now we see. Praise the Lord. Yes. So you've been there, and you sat down in the chair, and you're ready for the big bug eyes thing to come. You take off your glasses, and you see the eye chart at the opposite wall. And if you're anything like me, you can't see anything there. I have terrible vision. So even that big letter E right at the top, I have no chance, not even if I squint. So you have that moment, you know, just blindness, and here comes the bug eyes thing in front of you. And the eye doctor starts to change the prescription that's in front of you, right? He has like every option under the sun. And he says, "Okay, Rachel, so here we are, and you know, this is what you currently have. Now tell me, is this or this better? Number one or number two? Number one or number two?" And you ask these questions, right? And you're feeling funny, and it's clicking away. I'm thinking eye doctor goes home to his wife at dinner time, and she's like, "Eye doctor, what do you want for dinner? Number one, number two." Right? But anyway, so he eventually gets it tuned up, and so he asks you, and then you read the lines, and so he's making sure you're not lying to him, and now you have a prescription. And we go to the eye doctor at Costco, and what he does is pretty effective. He gets those mock-up glasses frames, and then he opens the drawer with like hundreds of perfectly circular lenses, right, and puts in your two lenses that you need onto this dummy frame thing. And he takes you out into the corner, in the back corner of Costco, and you take off your glasses. He says, "Now look out and look at the numbers." And my response is, "What numbers? I see no numbers. There's nothing." I can't even see that large screen TVs that are the next display there at Costco. And by the way, they have curved TVs at Costco. Can't see those at all. I'm totally blind. But then he puts the lenses on, and all of a sudden, bing, Everything's in focus. It's awesome. Remember the first time Wesley ever had that experience? The lenses went on and Wesley says, oh! Just like, wow, look at that. And all of a sudden, your natural vision has been corrected. And you can see clearly. What a gift that is. When you go into the eye doctor and you say, I can't see well, and the eye doctor says, let me help you see well, nobody's feeling judgment. No one's saying, you should be able to see better than that. Wow, Rachel, you're a -7. That's like the worst I've ever even heard of. Oh my God. Right, you're not judged there. But you go in there, and he helps you, and you come out, and you can see clearly. I think that this can be a metaphor for us for prayer. This is week 12 in our series that we're going through all year about the Christian life. This middle section is the characteristics of every Christian life. Last week we talked about worship, all Christians worship. This week we're talking about prayer. We all are people of prayer. And why do we pray? I think 95% of the time, it might even be higher than that, the motivation for us to begin to pray is that we need to ask God to help us. We need to ask God to change something for us, usually. I remember when I was about to get married, I was in seminary, and one of the older ladies in my class came up to me, and she said, you know what your favorite prayer is going to be from now on? It's going to be, change in Lord! So we're asking God to change something, right? Our whole list of concerns. God, change something. Intercede, Lord. There's people who are suffering in their body, they're suffering in their mind, they're suffering in their life. God, change it. Intercede, intervene, change, change, change. We're asking God to do this. That's what motivates us and drives us to pray almost all the time. And so I'm going to ask you, is that all right? Is that okay? Yeah. It totally is. It might feel like, oh, maybe it's selfish. Maybe I shouldn't. No, it's absolutely okay. Ask, Jesus says, seek not, have audacious, what was it, shameless audacity, go and ask. The Bible is full of stories, Old Testament and New, of people reaching out to God and asking God, change it, Lord. And God changes God's mind in some cases. God changes what God does so that we can hear and that we can feel loved and so we can be provided for. Yes, pray for what needs to change, absolutely. And there is something else that happens when we pray. When we are asking God, I want you to change this. I want you to intercede and intervene, change it. God says, okay, but in the process, I'm also going to change you in the process of this prayer. You're asking for change over there. I'm going to bring you some change over here. And this happens particularly when we pray the way that Jesus taught us to. Ashton read through the skeleton or the bare bones of the Lord's Prayer that we say every single weekend. You may have learned this prayer like I did before I understood what I was saying. It may come out as like one very long word, by the way, right? You know, so it becomes rote and it becomes routine, but I thought it would be helpful to sort of break down the three different elements of what that prayer is doing, so that we can hear it a little bit fresher. As it turns out, there is an alliteration. And I am so thankful because alliteration really helps us. The three P's of prayer, how do you like that? And there's a bonus P too. So four P's of prayer. But the first P in the Lord's Prayer is position. We say, our Father, okay? Our Father who art in heaven. The very first thing is we are establishing the position between ourselves and God. God is like a parent to us. We are like children to parents. This is a healthy parent-child relationship. It is a loving parent-child relationship. God created us. We ask God for help, just like we would ask our parents for help, right? God guides us, instructs us, teaches us. This is the position that we have. God as a parent, us as a child. We remember that as we begin our prayer. What position do we have to God? The second P is purpose. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Purpose. What is the purpose of all this? What is the purpose of our life? What is the purpose of this thing going on outside the walls, the world? The purpose is that people would know that God loves them, right? That's the whole point, is that people would know that God loves them and have a relationship with God. That is the purpose. So we pray first and say, God, I know who you are and who I am. And second, we say, I know the purpose of all this is to be able to share effectively God's love of the world. That people would know that the kingdom of God is here. Justice and mercy and love and peace and kindness. All of those things. That is the purpose. Key number three is provision. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses. Not just physical provision. I need to eat today. I need shelter over my head, especially when it's 16 degrees when I wake up in the morning. Not just physical provision. And interestingly, just for today, that's all the prayer asks for, just today, physical provision, but also relational provision, right? Help me to forgive others. Help me to ask forgiveness. You forgive me, God. So it's relational provision, it's physical provision, it's spiritual provision between us and God. Restore, allow us to function well as people. But just today, give us this day our daily bread. Just today. What a very simple prayer that is. God, this is who we are together. This is what your purpose is for the world. Give me just enough today that I can help participate in your purpose of bringing the kingdom of God. And the bonus P, somebody else pointed this out to me. I never, how many times have we said the Lord's Prayer? I mean, how many days are there, right? Like 10,000 times. I never really reflected on the fact that this prayer is in the plural. It's not my Father who art in heaven, but our Father. It's written to be read in community, right? That this prayer is a community thing. How encouraging is that? That when you are praying to God in this particular form that Jesus gives us, that automatically you are including the whole community with you. So that you can say, it's not just me who feels like I have this relationship with God, who feels like I understand the purpose of God's plan for the world, the kingdom of God, or that I'm the only one doing this work. Here's a whole community of people around me who are praying this together, who are in it together, who believe it together. That is so encouraging. So, position, provision, no, position, purpose, provision in the plural is what the Lord's Prayer does. When we go to God in prayer, we ask God to change things for us, which is good. And in the process, God changes us. It's like we've gone to a spiritual eye doctor. And without any judgment or criticism, God says, okay, your natural vision isn't really good. And so I'm going to switch the lenses a little bit for you. And I'm going to help you to see more clearly. So that after we're done praying together and I've heard all the things that you want me to change, that when you walk out into the world into the Costco showroom, you're going to see with a set of eyes better than you ever have before. Going to prayer is like going to spiritual eye doctor so that we can see with the eyes of God. Amen. That was wicked short, but I want to tell you something. Best preaching advice ever. When you're done saying what you're going to say, stop talking. So, but Daniel, that means you got to be in here playbook.
I'll just get Daniel to play for the rest of the
Yeah, Daniel, let's play us a little something, darling.
You got 8 minutes. Just go.
He was noodling around with some very secular George Michael before church. So. It's time for our offering. Let's pray. Lord God, we ask that you would help us to humbly and gratefully accept the times that you change our vision. Help us to have your vision for this world. Help us to want to be part of your purpose. We ask, God, that you would receive the offering that we give you this morning and feel our gratitude, that you would bless it and multiply it to your service in this world. We pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Tip P, we need to practice. So, I'm not going to let it go, because listen, I thought of this sermon. This came on Friday night, and on Saturday morning, and this morning. I have my practices to not look at my phone until I read my Bible. Some of you know this. It works so well for me. So I read my Bible, and then each time I pray, and I use this little format. Okay, what's my position? What's the purpose? What's the provision? And so I want you to hear my prayer. I'm going to do it for you right now. And I want you to consider, when you pray, to just do it with that format, with these 3 points. Because it was so effective, it's so simple, and it's just laser-like focus on the real purpose of what we're doing. So this morning, for example, I prayed, God, I know you made me, I know you love me. Thank you for creating me the way you have, even though I've got faults and flaws. But thank you for giving me the gifts you have, and thank you for loving me. I would like to be a part of your plan for this world. I would like to be a part of your kingdom. Just help me to figure out how I can do that today. Show me things about showing your love to other people. And give me just as much as I need today to be able to have food and shelter so that I can be in good relationship with others. And then it was just that short. So if you haven't yet, write it down. Position, purpose, provision. And see if that helps you in your prayer life this week. All right. There you go. Instead, we're going to have have it on New Year's Eve at 11 a.m. We're going to do that because a lot of people like to stay up and kick the gong around on Saturday night. So this way we get to sleep in Sunday morning. But we will be meeting Saturday for worship on New Year's Eve at 11 a.m. at the Congregational Church. And then January 8th, back to normal, back to 10:30 worship at Aldersgate. So that is our holiday schedule. For celebration and thanks, I received just the most wonderful email from Lori Downs this week, who was touched and really overwhelmed by the response of this church to the Take a Tag program. Lori, do you want to give us, there you are. How many tags did we do?
We had 60 tags.
We had 60 tags, and so we gave 60 gifts, and a lot of people gave wrapping paper and things that could be used to wrap those gifts. So Lori, thanks. All those who have participated in the Take a Tag program. All right. What happened? I mean, Terry, it's just so fast this morning. I have no idea. It's great. Y'all, it's a bonus. It's my gift to you this morning. Have a little bit more time over the fellowship and conversation. All right, please stand for the benediction. Lord God, we're grateful for the gifts that you give us, both practical and tangible, and just spiritual, Lord, and relational. We thank you for that. We thank you for the gift of prayer that allows us to be closer to you and to see the world through your eyes. We pray that you would bless us and be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.